The victory by Stephen Roach last year took a severe toll on his body. Injury has put him out of this year's race. The door is open for America's Andy Hampstead. Last year's tour was a failure. This year, he stunned the cycling world with a win at the Tour of Italy. These cyclists have gathered once again, as they have since 1903, for this annual rite of summer. They'll take the entire month of July and make all of France their battleground. Tomorrow they'll begin their 2,000-mile journey, which will take them 21 days. Each and every cyclist knows the toll this gruesome race can exact. Is it courage that drives these cyclists beyond their limitations? One thing is certain. In this race, it takes more than pain to stop riders who have trained a lifetime just to finish. It is truly one of the greatest events in all of sport. A journey through postcard-like settings, along shores, fields, and mountains of France. Through antiquated villages it goes, touching the lives of young and old alike. Over, they will have parted a sea of millions en route to the finish line. Their goal, Paris. And the yellow jersey, like this one worn by Greg LeMond in 1986 as the first American to ever win the Tour de France. Can an American win again? Consecutive year, we at CBS Sports are proud to present the Tour de France.
Welcome to Paris in the famed Champs-Élysées, where in just 21 days, the 1988 Tour de France will finish here on this fabled boulevard. And hello again, everybody. I'm Tim Brandt. For the next 3 weeks, we at CBS Sports will bring you our exclusive coverage of the greatest bicycle race on earth. Not since 1986, when Greg LeMond won here, has an American been considered a legitimate favorite. But this year, Andy Hampstead of Boulder, Colorado, is one of a handful of riders that have a legitimate chance of winning. Now, while LeMond won with the support of an experienced French team, a win by Hampstead would be virtually revolutionizing the sport. His American team, scorned just 2 years ago, has now become one of the best in the world.
The finish line at the Tour of Italy. It symbolizes the second most important cycling event in the world. And just 3 weeks ago, Andy Hampstead became the first American to ever win that event. While it's understood this is not the Tour de France, the win symbolizes one of the true cycling marvels in that Andy Hampstead and his American-based team has made such great strides in such a short period of time. They beat the Europeans at their own game.
Our team was the strongest. We came out on top. And we did it. We didn't change anything at the Giro. We kept racing like we have been for 3 years, and it worked. It's like we've been doing this experiment, you know, let's race, let's find our own style of racing and follow it and see how far we can go. And we won one of the biggest races.
The experiment began in a very unlikely laboratory. In 1986, before Andy Hampstead, the 7-Eleven team grew out of a house in Boulder, Colorado. And though inexperienced in the ways of big-time racing, they showed a bit of American bravado and took on the greatest race in the sport, the Tour de France. It took only 2 days to put Alex Steed in the yellow jersey, and his win gave his team immediate confidence, albeit guarded confidence, in a race measured in weeks, not days.
We're cavemen, what can I say? We're bad to the bone, at least the first day.
It didn't even last that long. Less than 6 hours later, Alex Steeda and the 7-Eleven team crumbled. The hardships were about to multiply. One by one, they fell as the race came crashing down and the realities of the tour struck home. Even for the strongest, like Eric Heiden, the task became insurmountable. They had indeed paid a heavy price for their inexperience. They weren't the only American newcomers that year. Andy Hampston, a relative unknown, made his debut with the French La Vie Claire team. His great climbing ability caught the attention of Greg LeMond and Bernard Hinault. And instantly, he was part of one of the greatest teams cycling had ever seen. In LeMond's quest for victory in 1986, Hampston became the closest ally and a major asset in his eventual monumental success. Hampston's reward was a phenomenal fourth-place finish and the coveted white jersey as the top newcomer.
My 1 year on La Vie Claire was a gift. My luck, being able to ride on that team in that year, that was the best team ever, well, probably ever in the history of the sport.
The following year, Hampston shocked the experts by leaving the proven La Vie Claire team for the virtual unknown Mavericks of the West. When we come back, we'll see how he and his team stack up against the European machine. Although Hampston's move was criticized by virtually everyone abroad, the temptation and motivation of leading his own team was too much for Hampston to turn down. It was evident even before last year's tour, they had become a more disciplined and organized team. The first European test came in the Tour of Switzerland. And in the final day of the race, Andy Hampston was protecting a one-second lead and fighting to keep the yellow jersey. Hampston had won this race the year before with a French team, but few gave him a chance to repeat with his new American team. They defended the yellow jersey and proved the experts wrong. This was the first time an American professional team had won a major race in Europe. In the Tour de France, the team carried the momentum they had gained in Switzerland, and sparked by the addition of Dag Otto Lauritzen, 7-Eleven was now winning stages in the most demanding of all races. It's been said that success is not a destination, but a continuous journey, and the 7-Eleven team was now on the right road to victory. Davis Finney won a stage. And the Americans capped off a successful tour with Jeff Pierce winning the most prestigious stage in Paris. Was being learned by all team members, and Raul Alcala emerged as a future star who was making an immediate impact, finishing ninth in the tour and earning the top rookie jersey. But with all the team success, Andy Hampston's tour turned into a disaster. The man 7-Eleven had looked to as their leader was living his worst nightmare. In the tour's most crucial stage, the one Andy Hampston knew he had to win, he lost 6 minutes to the leader. And his dream of winning the tour had been shattered.
By being hard on myself, it was destructive, and I wasn't going to be able to improve, and I would actually destruct if I kept being really hard on myself. So after the Tour de France, things changed. My major goal had just exploded. And I knew there's a lesson in there. I knew that either I was going to repeat my same mistakes forever in my career. You know, my body would be a little bit stronger because it'd be 1 year more mature, but that 1 year wasn't enough. I needed to improve a lot if I was going to win the Tour de France.
Boulder, Colorado is Andy Hampston's sanctuary. It is here he returned after his victory at the Tour of Italy to prepare for the Tour de France. He is the middle child of five and the son of two English professors. Drawing from his roots, he approaches life philosophically. And at a time when most cyclists would like to be surrounded by teammates, Andy chooses to be alone. When he first moved here 6 years ago, he was an amateur, a virtual unknown. Now, as a professional, he returns here on the threshold of a Tour de France victory. For him, the physical limits of cycling take on a mystical dimension.
The feeling that the iPad and my competitors share with me, you know, when we've pushed our body absolutely to the limit, is euphoric. It's there's no other emotion, there's no other feeling like it. There's nothing better for a human being to push themselves as far as they can go and then come back and just, wow, you know, I can't believe my body went that far.
Suffering is a very real part of bicycle racing. And learning to deal with pain is paramount if you are to have any success at all. The rules are well defined. Push the body beyond its limitations. Test every muscle and sinew. Overcoming oneself and the elements. The only way to victory. It is just one day now until we get our first sign, indicating whether or not Andy Hampstead and the American team are ready to win the 1988 Tour de France. While Andy Hampstead was in Boulder, Colorado, French cyclists were competing for their national championship. Phil Liggett was there scouting the teams.
The main talking point about this year's Tour de France is its distance. At 1,900 miles, it'll be the shortest race since 1905. Last year, it was 2,500. That should ensure a very quick and a very intense race. It'll make the mountains more important than ever, and the time trials absolutely imperative. Here at the French Championships, the French people are looking for confirmation. They have a challenger for the race this year. For me, I think there are three. There's Charlie Motte, who was fourth last year. There's Laurent Fignon, twice winner, but hasn't really regained that form and is always dogged by injury. And so I believe that there is really one man who can win this race for France, Jean-Francois Bernard. He's 26, he finished third last year, and this year he's won two stages in the Tour of Italy. One thing is for sure, though, that among the 22 teams, each one believes he can have a winner. It's going to be a great race, a very intense race, possibly a record speed, and a race I don't want to miss.
Last year, Jean-Francois Bernard laid the foundation to be France's main hope this time after his performances in the Tour de France climaxed with the greatest stage win of his career. Cheered on by the thousands who lie in Mont Ventoux, the giant peak of Provence, the Frenchman finally delivered the goods. What his mentor, Bernard Tapie, a self-made millionaire and former team owner, had said of him had finally come true. Tapie spotted Bernard as a youngster and promised him a Porsche motor car if he won a stage in the race. He did. He still has the car. The public adore their new hope following the retirement of Bernard Hinault, the five times Tour winner. And after Jean-Francois' third place last year and the yellow jersey for just a day in Provence, Bernard will feel all the pressure of being France's prodigal son this time. It's a role which suits him rather well.
Moi, je trouve que le jaune, ça me va pas mal.
I think, you know, Jean-Francois Bernard this year is going to be a hard man to beat because he is also a star for the last 5 or 6 years, and everybody forgets that, you know, he's still a seven-year professional and he's 27 years of age. So I think he knows himself that this year he must perform, otherwise, you know, they'll just turn the page and talk about somebody else. And the fact also that he's worked out in France and it's, you know, he's been showing up reasonably well this year also. I think he is my man for the win.
Of all the world
Bell's team managers, Cyril Guimard is the best known. His face delights the cartoonist and his actions excite the crowds. Since being forced out of cycling with a knee injury, but not before, he finished fourth in the Tour and won 10 stages, Guimard has concentrated on training winners. In fact, 8 of the last 10 Tour winners had at one time been trained by him. Guimard's always been different to the rest, being part coach and part businessman. He always gets the team he wants, and the corporate sponsor likes the results it gets. His current team is backed by System U, a supermarket chain. The riders, however, are contracted to a company co-owned by Guimard and Tour winner Laurent Fignon. Known as the sorcerer, Guimard has a shrewd eye for judging talent. He saw it in Laurent Fignon long before Fignon dreamt of a Tour victory. The blonde warrior quit school after Guimard convinced him he could win the race. But first, Guimard brought him along slowly until he was ready. The strategy paid off. Fignon won in 83 and 84. After Greg LeMond won the World Championship, Guimard was alert again. The American was next on his list as a future Tour winner. But the partnership that made both men world famous was that between Guimard and Bernard Hinault. A split was to come, but not before they enjoyed 4 victories together. Cycle racing is now more popular than ever. Billions of dollars pour into the sport each season, placing more demands on Guimard's time. Not as a coach, but as a businessman. Success means survival in a bitter commercial world. Guimard has built a main squad of 16 riders, and although only 9 will ride the Tour de France, he's built a team that, in true musketeer fashion, is all for one and one for all. The yellow jersey is the target for publicity. The team may not win the race, but to lead will guarantee commercial exposure. Guimard plans 2 strategies this year, to try and capture publicity by winning stages and hopefully win the race itself with Laurent Fignon or Charlie Motte. The team has 2 aces. Guimard works hard to keep the team together as a family. The team will ride perhaps 150 races in a season, which lasts 8 months. So it's essential that morale stays high and squabbles are not allowed to develop into major splits. Here, just a week before the Tour, Guimard knows that it's more important to keep the spirits high than to overtrain. The preparation by now is done. And like a godfather, Guimard watches over his team. And although he appears jovial and easygoing, he's always alert to the development of situations that might destroy his dreams of further success. When you're running a $3.5 million team, discipline is bound to be rigid. And even on the training rides, the team looks professional and rides hard. After all, if they don't provide the performances, then Guimard will not renew their contracts next season. But while the team is working out on the roads of France, Guimard is back in his hotel room, taking care of the day-to-day business in the most complex world of administration and making deals. Unlike other teams who are contracted direct to the corporate sponsor, Guimard himself is responsible for the monthly paychecks for his riders, a responsibility until now no coach has been prepared to take on. Some hate Guimard, others love him, but all respect him, including one former pupil.
For young riders, he's always been the best coach in Europe. And that was when he was with Renault. Now it's with System U, it's his own team, it's his own money. I think things have changed a lot. And I could go back to him, but I don't think he would ever want to work with me again. Mainly because I think that it's like Guimard, once you leave him, he never wants to have the riders back.
Seen then as the greatest coach of the day, Guimard, by gambling his own money, has brought about a major change in the structural setup in professional cycling. And through the legs of his current crop of riders, Guimard hopes to enjoy another successful Tour.
Hey, better.
And of Greg LeMond?
Foul ball! Steer right to!
We'll find out when we return.
This is
Dublin Bay, just a few days before the tour, and last year's champion Stephen Roach is left with plenty of time to reflect on his historic victory. For the second year in a row, injury has reduced the previous tour winner to a spectator. 1987 was the year of Stephen Roach, who won the tours of France, Italy and the world title. His homecoming drew the biggest crowd since President Kennedy and the Pope came to Dublin. It took him 4 hours to cover the last 200 yards to his home. This year should have been his happiest. A new team and a reported $3 million salary, Roach could wear his World Championship rainbow jersey with pride. But instead, his season has been a disaster. Roach has ridden only a handful of races, finishing practically none. And he's been forced to spend the year visiting knee specialists in France, Spain and Germany in a bid to put right an injury which keeps reoccurring since he crashed during a race almost 2 years ago. Roach has a form of tendonitis in his left knee, which causes it to become too painful when under pressure. The doctors have told him to stop racing, otherwise the knee will...
Becoming-